Blog Talk Radio.
Hi, this is Frank Lopresti, and you're listening to Pam and Dawn.
Hello, and welcome to the special edition of Christmas MuVies Spotlight. I'm your host, Don Mack, and I'm here with...
Hey, this is Zane Stephens, and you're listening to Pam and Dawn.
Hello, and welcome to Christmas MuVies Spotlight. I'm your host, Don Mack, and I'm here with my friend, wonderful colleague, and tremendous host, Pam. Hey, Pam, how are you?
I love that as the season goes on, I get more and more accolades.
I know, really? And this time, you know, I think, what, a show or so ago, I was saying that I always do, like, the little jazz hands when I'm going, Pam.
Yeah.
I didn't do that today. I was, like, mindful going, don't do that, don't do that. The listeners can't see it anyway, so I was told today.
But you know what? It's okay if you do it, because the only one that's going to see it is your cat.
That's true, and my cat is on my bed currently. She's currently on my bed in a big blanket, bundled up, curled up, and sleeping as we speak. So she missed it altogether, and I'm not doing a replay. So she's just out of luck.
Yep. She's
oh my gosh.
I saw that show before, so no big deal.
There you go. So how are you doing? Have you had a good week?
Yeah, it's been a week, let me tell you. The weather outside is not as frightful as you think it would be at this time of the year, so I'm good with that. How about you?
Well, our weather has been bordering on frightful only because this time of year we don't get 30s and 40s. We usually are more like 50 to 60 range, and so this has been a little bit of a change. I think I've been freezing all day today. I can't get warm, and I think it's just a mental thing because I know it's cold outside, and you know, and something is not computing going, hey, it is, you know, we're on the cusp of winter here, but North Carolina, that doesn't mean anything. So nonetheless,
yeah.
But yeah, other than that, it's been a busy week, but it's been a good week. So just glad to be here. And speaking of, we have got an interview tonight that we are so excited to bring to you. We had an amazing time speaking with Mr. Zane Stephens. He is immensely talented. Oh, my gosh. He was, you know, as you know, we do all of our interviews as pre-record. So we talked to him pretty early on in the season. And I'm telling you, what a blast he was. He was so energetic and just, he was just great, and a wealth of knowledge, too, as you will soon find out in a few minutes. What did you think about him, Pam?
Oh, yeah. I really don't have anything to add to that because I think you covered all the bases and all the adjectives and everything that goes along with it. Yeah, I love talking with him. I would love to have him back another time,
oh,
you know, maybe next season or something, whatever he's got going on.
Mm-hmm.
But, yeah, he was good. He was good. I enjoyed it. And Zane stars in the holiday movie, A Belgian Chocolate Christmas. Before I tell you where and when, I have to say that was one thing that made me crazy because after we interviewed him, it was like that's all that was on my mind was chocolate.
I'm thinking to myself, you know, Belgian chocolate and Christmas. How does it get any better than that, you know?
Right.
I mean, to tell you, Belgian chocolate and Christmas. I don't know about you, but I'm excited to see this movie because I know it's going to be chock full of chocolate. So if you're a chocolate lover, folks, you're in for a treat. Never mind the Christmas part. That's like the bonus. The chocolate is the focal point, folks. So, you know.
Yes. Yes, absolutely. Well, it premieres Sunday, December 11th on the streaming service Plex, and it's P-L-E-X. One of those ones that I just found out about, thankfully, because there's a lot of things on there that we can watch.
Yes. We are so excited and honored to bring you our interview now with Zane Stephens.
Enjoy the show.
Hello, Zane. Thank you so much for joining us tonight. We really appreciate you taking the time. We're so excited to speak with you today.
Of course, ladies. It is my pleasure. Thank you for having me.
You're very welcome. I hope that your day is going well.
Oh, you know what? When you're a dad, every day is fun and things break. And I have two boys, so something broke today, which is normal. And someone cried, which is normal. And someone punched me, which is also normal. So,
was it dad that cried?
Yes, it was. No. Well, no, when I got punched, yes. Actually, I hit in the back of the head today. Heads are supposed to be off limits, but today was the back of the head, and I was like, oh, dude, what's the rule, man? No head, no faces, no heads.
Well, I completely understand that. I have three boys and a girl, and my daughter, when she was home alone with me, it was like she wasn't even here. I never knew she was here. Like, she could be playing so nice with her dolls all day long, never say a word. Okay, come on, Olivia, it's time to eat. You know, what do you want to do now? The boys, forget about it.
Yeah.
Forget about it.
I don't know what it is. It's like, everyone's like, hey, listen, boys are great. Boys are great. I'm like, they are great, but it's crazy, you know?
Yeah.
Clothes get ripped off. Sometimes my youngest just takes off his pants and walks around, and it's like I'm like, what is going on in this house right now?
That's hilarious.
Oh, boy life, I guess. I don't know.
Boy life for sure.
Well, what was it like for Zane growing up? I mean, is that when you decided you wanted to be an actor, or did that come later in life?
It came a little later. You know, I grew up wanting to be a baseball player. And I played a lot, and I pretty much devoted my life to it. I was on travel teams growing up. I traveled all over the country. My parents were fortunate enough to do that, and I was fortunate enough to have parents that would let me do that. It wasn't until I was about 18 when I was looking at colleges, and I had received a few scholarships, and I was kind of thinking through, okay, my arm's sore. You know, I'm not a great hitter. There's a lot of work I got to do to get where I need to be to play professionally. And I just didn't know if I wanted to put in the work. And the only other thing I was interested in was movies. I was like, I just love watching movies. And so I talked to my coach my senior year. I said, hey, coach, I don't think I'm going to play. And he wasn't happy. But I was like, hey, listen, I'm going to play this year. But I don't think I'm going to play post high school. And he said, well, what are you going to do? I was like, I don't know, man. I love movies. So actually, there was like a small town in Atlanta. I Googled tryouts for acting, you know, because in the baseball world, it's in the sports world, it's tryouts and, you know, the acting world.
Right.
Anyway, I put tryouts for acting. And this little thing came up, and it was The Wizard of Oz. And I was like, oh, cool, I love The Wizard of Oz. I'm going to go audition or try out to be in The Wizard of Oz. Well, I went and ended up booking The Scarecrow and found out that it was a children's production, and it was traveling from daycare to daycare after school. And so it was like this. I had to rap if I only had a brain. I mean, it was like totally not what I'm sitting there watching, like, Tom Cruise action movies. I'm like, yeah, I'm going to do this. But I ended up doing it, and I was like, wow, this is so much. I mean, just making kids laugh was just a joy, and it made me really happy just to make people smile. And I was like, maybe I do want to be an actor. And then I started investigating what that really looked like, and I went to a big competition in Orlando right after I graduated, and I met my reps there, and I moved to LA right after that. And so I kind of moved to LA when I was 18, and that is kind of when I started acting. And so it was a later in life thing for me.
Well, you know what they say. I mean, obviously everyone has to start somewhere, right? And the fact that you did that and loved it, and wanted to continue pursuing acting, that is a real testament to the passion that you had for that. And the rest, they say, is history, you know?
Yeah. You're right. I mean, like, there's something that just, I don't know, it's something that makes me really happy to make people feel, to make them move, you know, I always say that my job as an artist is to meet the needs of the audience. So an audience, they come to the theater, they come to the screen to watch something, to be moved, to feel something. If it's a Christmas movie, it's to feel love and hope and family, you know.
Like
whatever role I'm in, it's like my job is just to make them, to meet their needs, to make them feel what they need to feel. And I learned that when I first started, and I was like, man, I never want to lose this. I want to do this for the rest of my life. So it just happened to be with kids.
Well, that's right. And, you know, but you set the stage for what was to come, obviously. And what has been the most rewarding part of your career thus far?
So it's a kind of, there's a couple answers I could give you. In terms of personal achievement, I was on a show called, The First Lady on Showtime, and it wasn't a big role, but it was a really heavy role. And I had never done anything like that as an actor. And it's a scene where, to Eleanor Roosevelt, you know, Gillian Anderson plays Eleanor Roosevelt, and I play her father in the past. And so I'm talking to little Eleanor, and, you know, we're at my wife's funeral, and, you know, I'm an alcoholic. I play Elliot Roosevelt, and this character is an alcoholic, and he has some mental illnesses. And he basically, as his daughter is, I think she was six, he basically has to say, I'm not fit to take care of you. You're going to live with your grandmother. And it's just like, and it just required a whole bunch of stuff that I didn't know I had in me. And I think, for me personally, being able to go there, I used my own kids just in my own mental process. Like, what would it be like for me to say to Cash, which is my oldest, or Noah, my youngest, say, I'm not fit to be your father. That it just broke me. And so to be able to kind of step into that and to be able to execute it well and really be honest in the moment, that's a personal achievement of mine that I will probably forever think about when someone says, hey, what's something that made you proud as an actor? Just because it was the first one. I mean, I had never been able to go to that depth before. So that's probably the easiest answer.
Yeah, I think that's why one of the reasons that I couldn't be an actor, because dealing with all those different emotions, and I watch people cry on TV, and probably 90% of the time those are real tears, and you hear the stories of how they get those tears to flow, and it's always something so sad. And I just was like, oh, I don't know if I could do that, because I would probably carry that home with me.
Some actors do that. I'm not saying one's better than the other, but for me personally, I try to leave work and then go home and be a dad and a husband.
Yeah.
Because it's really hard. I mean, you kind of get into like this, for me, what I'm experiencing is you kind of get into like this identity issue where when you stay in some mental state for too long, and you kind of disassociate yourself from your own life, you kind of begin to wonder who you are. Like, you kind of have like this thing. So I try to when I go to set, that's when I put on my emotional cap, or that's when I try to get into the moment. And then when I leave, when director says cut and Zane, you're wrapped, I try to like shake it off and leave the wardrobe there and leave the emotions there and go home and be a dad. But it's not, you're right. It's not easy. And that's, you know, but that's how I try to do it. And sometimes my wife's like, go back to set. I don't want you. I'm just kidding. She's awesome. She's a huge supporter of mine. But no, you're right. It can be tough to shake that.
Right, exactly. Well, at this point, not only have you been acting, but you've also written and produced and directed several projects. Do you see yourself writing and being behind the camera more?
I do love that process. You know, there's something about steering the ship versus just being like a rudder that is fascinating to me. And what I mean, like as a writer, director, producer, you're kind of it's your vision, and it's your job to make sure that it's executed well. And as an actor, my job is just to kind of move the way people tell me to move, for lack of a better term. I still have a job to do, and it's got to be honest and real. But it's someone else's story that I'm stepping into, and that was what I fell in love with. And that's what I foresee myself doing for the rest of my life, if that's possible. But there is something special and something magical and something very challenging about stepping behind the camera and writing a story from scratch, and finding a way to make it come to life on screen so that the audience is moved. So there is something that is very intriguing to that about that with me. And you know, I have a couple in production. We're in the fundraising phase for a couple of them, and some are close to going. I made some pitch material of a horror film. I know it's not really the Christmas space, but I made a personal project, and it did. I made pitch material, and a producer signed on, and that's the investors are kind of looking at it, and it might go. But I made pitch material, and that ended up winning an award at the Atlanta Horror Film Festival a few weeks ago, actually. So it's definitely something that I want to do. Seeing is my heartbeat, and that's what I fell in love with, and that's probably where I'll stay. But if I get a chance to write, produce, and be behind the camera, I'll definitely take it for sure.
Yeah, and I think the wonderful thing about your career is that, you know, the sky's kind of the limit. You can do as much of it as you want, whether it be acting or mm-hmm. any of the other facets that kind of pull it all together for the sake of entertainment. Sure. And that's a beautiful right. thing. Well, I'm going to shift gears a little bit, because here's something sure. that viewers don't hear every day, and that's while filming Darkness in the Valley, you contracted poison ivy. And
yeah.
So how in the world did you do that, and how did you finish filming with it, dealing with that?
Yeah, that was a hot mess. So we were shooting in Massachusetts, out in kind of central Massachusetts, where nothing exists but trees. And we were shooting in the woods, and it was like this 1600s piece. So we were out in the woods shooting, and somehow I don't even know how I contracted it. I don't know which sequence it was, but on the second to last day of shooting, I'm like incredibly itchy, and I'm like, what is going on? And then when I undressed that day with my wardrobe, it was literally I'm not kidding. It was so uncomfortable. It was literally from like my waist down to my ankles everywhere.
Oh my gosh.
On both legs. And I mean, I was like, it was really rough. Without going into too many details, I didn't want to stay clothed. It was just very uncomfortable to be clothed, and it was hot. It was summer. It was I think it was August. So I was constantly sweating, and that made it worse. It just made it really uncomfortable. And it lasted a long, long time. I was like, why is it still here? I think calamine lotion? Is that what it's called?
Yeah.
I mean, I like doused my legs and everywhere around that area in calamine lotion. It felt like for weeks, and it was just like, I like used my hand to like air dry it. I kind of like, just, I just needed like, it was the worst.
Yeah, and sometimes when it gets so bad, I mean, the doctors will prescribe like prednisone or something to try and clear it up and get it under
yeah.
control really quickly, depending
yeah,
on how
and
severe
I
it is.
I wish I would have gone, but I was in Massachusetts, and I was like, I just got to finish this.
Yeah.
And then I went from there to a family vacation, and so it was like, it wasn't like, I didn't go home. It was one of those cases where I definitely should have gone to the doctor and gotten something to help, like some kind of steroid or something, but it mm-hmm. or prednisone. But it was I just suffered.
Unbelievable. I mean, anything can happen when you're filming somewhere, I would imagine, especially when it's not someplace that you're familiar with.
You don't know.
That it doesn't happen again.
Yeah, no. I'm going to – wood scenes, when it says ext.woods, I have learned to ask the really important questions. and I've shot several of them recently, and I have been over-prepared. Ankles wrapped so nothing gets in the bottom of the clothes, and make sure – I mean, I just make sure that I'm, like, locked up. Nothing can touch my skin.
Right.
So, yeah, so that's – I learned my lesson early on, and now I make the adjustments.
Yeah.
I ask an AD for help. Hey, can we get some, like, extra bug spray? Ticks are terrible. Can we, anything
Absolutely.
Might be possible, so.
Wow. Well, I hope that in rebuilding the Christmas dream, that was smooth sailing, because we loved that movie. Your character Josh, he was just, oh my gosh, he was just wonderful. And he helped Ashley with fixing her house that her grandmother left her. We saw you baking and skating. How much of Zane was in that character of Josh?
So, I mean, Christmas movies that I do or that I've done, you guys are going to see probably more of me than not. That film was great. I actually talked to the DP and the director today about something, and we're so close. We still keep in touch, and they're really good people. And I had a really great experience on that set. But Josh is just me. You know, other than the fact that, like, a handyman, I'm not a Zane is not a handyman. Zane has to, like, no. Yeah, I unashamedly, I will admit, okay, Zane is not a handyman. I know what a hammer is, but that's about it. and so, actually, my dad's a builder. So one of the lines was something like, yeah, I think your fascia is broken, or I don't know, whatever the line was. And I was like, Dad, what the heck is a fascia? You know, so there's, like, these things, right? I call my dad, be like, hey, what is this? He's like, why do you care what that is? I was like, I don't know, it's in a movie, man. I just got to, like, listen, know what I'm talking about. You know what I'm talking about. that part was definitely not Zane. That part was totally, I gotta act like I know what I'm talking about. But just the kind of the gentleness. I mean, I'm a pretty soft dude, and I just like to smile and laugh and have a good time, unless my kids are, you know, having a good time with me. But yeah, it's probably me more than not. Just laid back, likes to have a good time. Nice and easy going. So yeah.
Well, going from one Christmas movie to another, Pam and I, we are so excited to see you starring in a Belgian Chocolate Christmas coming soon. And what can you share about that movie without giving too much away?
Well, if you love chocolate and you love Christmas, then it is going to be the movie for you.
Oh,
yeah.
we actually went to Belgium to shoot a lot of the exterior, so you will be able to see, we shot in Brussels, a lot of the exteriors will be, so they're very beautiful. The architecture is ornate, and it's just, you know, you're walking on the streets and you see, like, buildings that say 1638 and 1542. It's like, wow, that's actually when these were built, and it's just very different than America. So from an aesthetic perspective, you're going to get to see some really beautiful things from Brussels, but from a heart level, my character is a chocolatier, and he runs a chocolate school, and people kind of pay him to come and have them learn how to make chocolate. And it's a legacy story for me. So the idea is, my character, Matthias, his grandfather passes away, and his grandfather kind of always entrusted him to be the person to take over the school. It's called the École de Chocolat de Bruxelles, which just means, you know, the chocolate school of Brussels. I do speak some French in it, not a lot, but I do have to speak a little bit. So I had to learn some French. And so it's this story where the school is dying, and he feels this burden, this responsibility to save his grandfather's legacy, and he doesn't know what to do. And this wonderful woman, played by Jaclyn Hall, she comes and kind of changes his life a little bit and brings innovation and then love. And he begins to see things differently, and his school has some happy endings, and Matthias and Kate have a happy ending as well. So that's there without giving too much away. There you go.
Yeah. Oh my gosh. I mean, it's we're going to be watching this movie, Craving Chocolate, the whole time. So at least Dawn and I will be prepared.
Yeah.
And
that's
have
right.
Chocolate.
Yeah. Hey, listen. Yeah, listen, I'm not even kidding. One of the things that I got to do when I was there was actually go to a famous chocolatier's class. And so I got to sit in and learn how to make this Belgian chocolate from this famous chocolatier in Brussels. And so I got to experience what it's like to actually be on that end. It's super. I mean, like it's chocolate. It's a lot of chocolate, and it's a very good chocolate. And I think everyone's going to really like it. I haven't seen a cut yet. You know, we only wrapped about a month ago, so I haven't seen a cut yet. But based off like looking at the dailies, I think people are going to really enjoy it.
Awesome. I think so too. I can't wait to see it. Now, in most Christmas movies, there are carolers and builders mm-hmm. and executives and all of the mm-hmm. different jobs that they have. Will we see you be singing anytime soon?
there is a singing scene, actually. There is a singing scene. And I was like, I was sweating bullets when that, I was like, are we shooting the scene today? I kept asking, when are we shooting the scene? It's a Christmas tree. We're decorating a Christmas tree, which happens in all these movies. And then we bust out in song. And it's one of those things where Jacqueline's character's like, hey, I did this. You need to do this. I won't laugh at you. So it's supposed to be like he's not a great singer, but he kind of like then like lets it out and starts belting when he's singing. Anyway, so we'll see what the final edit looks like. But yes, there is. You will get to hear my pipes at least for a moment, or lack thereof.
I love it.
Oh my goodness! Go ahead.
The best thing was that we got to shoot like on top of this massive Ferris wheel. I mean, it's huge. We literally, like, you know, the DP and one of the sound guys, we got into this little what is it, cart or whatever it is, in a Ferris wheel, and we literally just shot this scene going around and around and around the Ferris, and it was huge. And I had never done anything like that before. It was late, 10, 11 o'clock at night. You could see all of Brussels. It's beautiful. But that was a really cool and very cold and very high experience. But it was funny. We were kind of nervous. But you kind of forget when you're that high. You're like that feeling of like, oh my, like the it's moving. Like we're swaying and we're really high. Oh wait, I wait, what's my line? because you kind of like begin to feel like, oh, what if I fall? What happens if I crash? What happens if you're
right?
And you have dialogue.
Yeah, I have a hard time being on a Ferris wheel, especially when you like go to your state fair or something and they stop it to let people on at the bottom and you're at the very top. And I can't look forward. Somehow the whole thought I'm going to fall any second. So if I look behind it, somehow it doesn't affect me the same way. But wow, I haven't been on a Ferris wheel in a very long time. But yeah, it can be a little bit frightening.
I had not either, and I didn't think anything of it until we actually got to the Ferris wheel, and I looked up, and I was like, "Holy moly, that's
off
high.
The ground."
And we have dialogue to do. Are you sure? Can we like not do dialogue? Can we just cut the dialogue? Because I don't know if I'm going to do dialogue.
That's right.
I it would be a very pretty shot as well.
Oh, yeah, for sure. And see, we kind of know the backstory, Pam and I, which the typical viewing audience won't know, but we will. So it'll make it very special for sure.
Yeah, when you watch it, like, wait, Zane looks a little nervous right there. You'll know because we got really high. And I was like, I don't know what my line is.
He's very high.
I'm freaking out right now.
Although the shot won't culminate that. It won't capture that, but we will know.
Yeah,
so.
You will know. You
That's
will know.
Right.
Yeah.
Well, before we wrap up, we always like to play a little 5-question lightning round that is all Christmas themed. There are no wrong answers, by the way, but fun things about Christmas. So the first one is, what is your favorite Christmas tradition?
Favorite Christmas tradition. All right, so I'm going to say one. It's not my favorite. It is just the Christmas tradition that my family always does. And it is every Christmas Eve, we all do the 12 days of Christmas. And it's every single member of the family picks a day. And it is literally like a song and dance and like charade of the 12 days of Christmas. And there have been some, you know, absolutely hilarious years where, like, you know, my dad was six geese to lay in and my brother-in-law was seven swans to swim in. And so my brother-in-law's on the ground swimming and like my dad like squats down. So there have been some outrageously funny moments. And now that my kids are old enough to kind of do it, they love it too. I had years where I was like, can we not do this? But now my kids are
years.
Little, yeah, those teen, even like in my 20s, I'm like, do we, come on. Like, I'm a little too old.
But you know, those are the things that Christmas memories are made of with family and, you know, and just doing those special zany things, you know, and then you look back on it and go, those were good times.
Listen, the memory of my dad squatting on my brother-in-law's head is forever embedded in my head. It will forever be there.
For sure. So what is your favorite Christmas song?
Ooh, how about, anything Frank Sinatra has done? I mean, Oh, man, favorite Christmas song. It's the most wonderful time of the year.
That's a great choice. And there are no wrong answers, by the way. All right.
No.
Favorite Christmas movie?
Christmas Vacation.
Hot toddy or hot chocolate?
Hot chocolate.
And white lights or colored lights?
Well, that's a point of dissension in my family. Colored lights. Colored lights. I love colored. My wife loves white. So the deal that we have is the inside of the house can be colored. The outside has to be white.
Ah, well, that's a good compromise.
Yeah, and I think that most people do it that way. You don't really see a ton of colored lights outside, at least not in my neighborhood. It's more of the white lights. And then when you're walking past somebody's house, if their curtains are open, you'll see the colored lights on the tree. So,
right.
I could be so tacky and I could do everything in blues and greens, and multicolored. I mean, I totally would. I think it's awesome. Yeah. But my wife is like, no, Zane.
Oh my God.
She's the boss, so I say, sure. So.
She's probably telling you, pitch that in some future Christmas movie down the road, but not here.
Yeah.
Right.
Yeah. She's like, sure, if you want to go get paid to do that
in
your own movie, go for it. But in my house, it will not happen.
happy wife, happy life. So there you go.
100%.
Well, Zane, as you can tell, we absolutely love speaking with you today. You are so funny. You're so sweet. We just adore you, and we look forward to your movie projects. We welcome you back anytime, and we also wish you and your family a happy and blessed holiday.
Thank you. You guys as well. Thank you for having me. It's been great. Really appreciate it.
Sure.
You're very welcome. Take care.
All right. Bye, ladies.
Bye-bye.
Hey, guys. Don't leave us yet. Be sure to follow us on Twitter at Christmas Movies. That's XMASMUVIES. And also like our Facebook page at Christmas Movie Spotlight. Don't forget, that's spelled MUVIES. And follow us on Instagram at Christmas Movie Spotlight.
And don't forget to check out our website, ChristmasMoviesSpotlight.com. That's movies with MUVIES, ChristmasMoviesSpotlight.com.
Thanks for listening. See you next week.